So welcome to my talk. I'm glad so many are interested in this topic. As Adam said, rate my session in the end. I'd like to have some feedback, especially because this is my first go-to conference presentation. I'm normally having kind of more academic type of presentations. I start with introducing myself properly. So I actually was once a member of agile software development teams. I've been coding back then for 4 years after my university degree in information systems. But although it was really exciting to do this work and to work with the latest frameworks and kind of be part of a Scrum team, I found the users of the technology really interesting. So I've been looking for a PhD topic, and then I found the ideal topic so interesting in the University of Leeds. And that one was about mental models in the driving domain. So I actually did my PhD on mental models of eco-driving. So from the kind of really deep, like, software development work, from the coding, I went all the way to the human being, to the kind of psychology side of things. And after I submitted my PhD, basically 3 days later, I started my job in the University of Nottingham, where I'm now working as a research fellow for automotive human factors. So I stepped a bit back towards engineering again. And I'm mostly kind of working with automotive human-machine interfaces. So I've been working with mirrorless cars, for example. That was my first project, where the cars don't have the side mirrors outside, but instead they have screens on the inside of the cars. And the images are relayed by from cameras that can be placed anywhere outside of the vehicle. I've also been working with kind of emotions and experiences during driving, and I'm kind of moving towards human-machine interfaces in partially automated driving, which many in my field are working with at the moment. Oh, that's one too far. So I'm in the Human Factors Research Group. We are about 25 staff members, 30 PhD students, and we research kind of human factors in a really wide field. So we're looking at novel technologies and complex systems, which also reaches towards philosophy, actually. We're looking a lot at safety implications of systems, and then what kind of effects does the use of systems have on trust, and then user behavior and behavioral adaptations. There's a photo of my colleagues, the driving people within the group. We are about 5 staff members and 8 PhD students. Most of our work is funded by car manufacturers, but also by the EU and the UK government. And we're working with, in the automotive field, we're working with different issues about human-machine interfaces. A lot has to do with workload and stress and distraction as you're trying to drive and operate like the system, which kind of system, any kind of system at the same time can really kind of make your life a bit more difficult if we don't design them properly. But we are also looking at underload. So if driving feels really nice and easy, do you think you can then take more risks and actually drive faster because you kind of feel so safe? And do you maybe overtrust some systems as well, especially when it comes to automations? Of course, we're looking at the comfort and fit issues. Is it easy for you to reach the controls? Do you prefer touchpads over buttons or language interfaces easier or not? And of course, there's still work to do in the field of mental models, which is about drivers, the way drivers kind of understand and learn the different driving tasks, and to see also whether it's possible to automatize parts of them. So, and then after this introduction, let's get back to my presentation, to the question. So, as we're looking into automated driving, and especially kind of coming towards driverless cars, as we don't have the driver anymore, does it also mean that we don't need kind of human factors research anymore? Because I hear it actually a lot. I think maybe, I hypothesize, it could be a widespread opinion amongst engineers. And I just kind of had this question in my mind, and I wanted to get more to the bottom of this. And when I was asked to present at GoTo, I thought, that's my chance. So why are we looking at automated cars in the first place? I mean, what kind of problems do they solve? So traffic, I mean, it's very nice to drive in Denmark. This picture here on the situation, in this situation, is more like how it is in the UK, because it's British drivers spend a lot of time in traffic jams, and with implications on their well-being and their productivity. At the same time, driving is not particularly safe, and when you look at the accident statistics, 90% of the accidents can be traced back to human error. So there is some promise that things will be more efficient and safer and quicker with automation. So at this point, I want to make sure we're speaking the same language, so a few definitions. Automated means that certain tasks are taken over by machines, and it still means that other tasks that can be done by a human being. So in terms of cars, it could mean that the longitudinal control could be taken over, could be done by the car. That would be like an adaptive cruise control, for example, but the driver still needs to steer. So it can be like a more or less good teamwork situation between the car and the human being. At any time, it can also mean that at some times the car is having the full control and at other times the driver is having full control. And there we're getting to takeovers and handovers. A takeover is the situation when a driver is initiating, kind of taking back the control. So it often works by the driver overriding the automation, by an input into the steering wheel or by pressing a gas or brake pedal. A handover is initiated by the vehicle. The vehicle is just reaching the limits of its capabilities, and then is issuing some kind of alarm and handing back the control to the driver. When we talk about autonomous, we talk about kind of fully driverless cars. That is where even a blind person could drive from A to B, because the car just doesn't need to be controlled. Vehicle automation is understood to have several levels. I chose the classification by the Society of Automotive Engineers. Another one you find a lot in the media is by the NHTSA, the US Department for Transportation. It has one level less, but I prefer this one. It has a bit more detail. So the levels range from 0 to 5, and kind of from 0 to 5, the vehicle, as you can see in the green pluses, is getting more and more control, whereas the operator, the driver, is having less control over the levels. Level 0 is no automation at all. So the driver is doing the entire set of driving tasks. One thing that the vehicle could still do is to issue warnings. There are lane departure warnings or forward collision warnings. But I found it quite difficult to find a vehicle that is just issuing warnings, but not in any other way helping the driver. So I put a picture of a Ford T up here. Level one is assisted automation. So that means that the driver must be ready to take control at all times and monitor the driving environment continuously. So such systems, for example, include cruise control and adaptive cruise control, so where the car is, at least in certain conditions, able to do the longitudinal control, or the lateral control, where the car is kind of staying within the lane. It can also include parking assistance, for example, or some combination of these systems. One example, this is a picture from a VW Volkswagen Golf. This is an adaptive cruise control kind of system where the car is following a car in front at about a constant distance. And other examples are kind of park assists and kind of simple stop and go assists at very low speeds on the motorway and or in traffic jams. Level two is partial automations. So this is kind of getting a bit more sophisticated. The driver in this level is still obliged to have full situation awareness, to be fully aware of anything that's around, and to be able to respond and take over at any time. So it's not a given that the car can actually handle all situations. An example is an adaptive cruise control that's not able to brake. So it's like an adaptive cruise control system that's manipulating the gas pedal and coasting and giving more gas and coasting again. But when a brake is required, the driver needs to press on the brake. So one example is the in the Mercedes-Benz, the Distronic Plus with steering assist. So it's like an adaptive cruise control with steering. So to some degrees, the car can actually drive on its own, but that's not reliable, and the human being needs to be there. And the human needs to observe the environment at all times. So then we're getting a level further, and we're looking at conditional automation. Here, the car is actually able to drive on its own and to monitor the environment in certain conditions, for example, just on the motorway, or just like in slower traffic and congestion. And during those times, the driver can also kind of divert their attention for a bit. But they still need to be able to take back control and to drive. So I put a picture of the Tesla up here, because that is actually that's a good example of a car being able to drive on the motorway. It's like a chauffeur on the highway or in a traffic jam. When we talk about level four, we are not expecting the human being to be fully capable and able at all times to actually drive. There's a bit more kind of tolerance, and the driver might just be required at some points to take over some of the control. Or it might even be possible that the car is completely autonomous on the motorway only. And as an example, I put up a Google pod, although it's there's still some discussion, basically, which car belongs exactly to which level. But it's expected that such cars can actually do quite a high level of automation already. Another example would be a highway pilot that is able to do this ad hoc platooning to kind of dock onto other cars on the highway on its own and dock off again. And level five is the full automation, where the car can, on its own, drive from point A to point B, and everything the driver needs to do is to, the human has to do, is to switch on the system and to put in the destination. One example I found is the Park Shuttle in Rotterdam. It's like an autonomous shuttle system that's working in this kind of business park type environment at very low speeds, and it's quite restricted, and it still works with kind of magnetic guidance in the road. So the current state of the art is at level three, basically. So the major car manufacturers, the high-end manufacturers, are all bringing level three automation onto the market. And but there are also car manufacturers who kind of make this technology more affordable for the masses. So it's not just for those people with a lot of money. So it seems like automation will be available. And I also want to make clear that Tesla's current level of automation is a level three. So legally, there needs to be a capable driver on the driver's seat and able to drive at all times. So it's not a fully autonomous vehicle. Whether Google is on level 3 or 4. It's not yet really clear. What has been shown is that it is still happening, that the Google car is reaching the ends of its limits and handing the control back to the driver. So there are hundreds of those situations recorded. At the same time, there are also about, at the time when I looked this up, about 70 takeovers recorded, where those which were initiated by the driver. A proper level 5, like full automation, is not expected to be on the roads, out there, able to drive fully from one point to another. It's not expected for another 10 years or more. The opinions differ. I mean, some people say it takes 20, 30 years. Looking at level 3. Level 3 automation, or say, in general, the intermediate levels where the car is taking over the automation for sometimes, and the driver is driving actively at other times. It's a big field in research and development. And as there still needs to be this responsible driver in the car, and kind of having the driver engaged in the driving task is, it's not very easy. So I'm having, this is a video from an experiment we did. It doesn't have any sound at the moment. But the system is giving the control to the participant very soon. So there it is. So the system, you can see on the green bar, is perfectly comfortable driving on a motorway on its own, and the participant kind of took her hands off the steering wheel quite soon, trusted quite soon, and she's relaxing, having some water, looking around and picking up her phone, and she will pick up her phone at some point, and yeah, people are getting quite kind of detached from the driving task quite soon. I noticed this myself. Even people who report that they don't really trust automation, when they get into the situation, very soon they detach and are not engaged anymore in the driving. And as the level, the green bar shows, in this situation, it's fine. But it's also kind of deteriorating. It starts deteriorating. So it just went from green to orange. So the participant still has a phone, but she is kind of every now and then looking at the driving environment and looking at the system. What's happening here is, you know, the car is on the motorway, and it's kind of able to follow the traffic in front, but there's some fog coming up. Unfortunately, the quality of this video is a bit, it's not very good, so I can't really show the driving environment. So the participant is still quite disengaged and is looking at her phone. And another participant in the same experiment was watching films. So now she put her phone away and is getting kind of ready, is looking around. She has one hand already on the steering wheel. So she's she just set up, is kind of ready to drive, is monitoring the system. She's probably expecting that something is about to happen. And there's no sound yet. But once this bar is getting over to red, there will be a loud beep, and the control will be handed over to the driver. You can see that quite soon. But in this situation, it looks really good. I mean, the participant is doing a very good job in looking around and kind of getting ready to drive at any moment. So this should happen. Yeah, so here we are. So system is red. Car is not able to do this task anymore. A loud beep is coming on. And the car is still driving, but there will soon be a symbol, and then so now the participant is driving again. And you can see on her steering movements that it's quite easy for her to drive again, and to have control over the car. So I show you another participant. So he's, so the car is taking control now. So he's taking the hands off the steering wheel, taking out a research paper and reading. And he is reading. He's reading the entire drive. He's very, very concentrated on the paper, and that's the only thing he does. He has a pen as well to make notes. And so he lets the system drive and do its job. And as you can see on the green bar, it's working perfectly. So now fast forward, probably 15, 20 minutes, and the system is at, yeah, its very limit. And the driver doesn't notice it at all, or the participant in the vehicle has no idea. Loud beep, big alarm, the driver is throwing away the paper, noticing that he still has the pen in the hand, puts the pen away, and there we are again. And you see the bigger steering movements to kind of, there are rather big corrections showing that he was not very confident in the situation and needed a bit of corrections to get back into the lane, into stable driving. So level 3 automation is very problematic. So as the car is driving, drivers are getting fatigued, they're getting tired, and wander away with their minds. And it can take a very long time for the drivers to take over again. Natasha Merritt from Leeds University conducted a study 2 years ago where she found that it can take up to 15 seconds for a driver to take control. And it can take up to 40 seconds to be fully able to control the vehicle again, like with smooth steering movements and to be kind of securely in the lane. And that is a very long time considering the split seconds it can sometimes take to get into a critical situation. Over time, skills can degrade. You have the case that the tasks that are automated are usually the ones that are easier. So imagine the drivers are kind of getting de-skilled over time and then suddenly have to take over when life is hard, when there's rain and fog and the situation is very complex. Of course, I mean, when drivers trust and have experience with automation, or the other way around, as they experience the automation, the trust increases. It can lead to overtrust and some complacency. And in the end, they can also be misused. And you might have seen the video clips by Tesla drivers or non-drivers sitting in the back seat. That is not very smart to do. It's actually not allowed to do because there still needs to be a driver. It's not autonomous driving. But there's the risk. So we also got to the first fatalities in this level of automation. We are looking at possible solutions in research with this. So we are looking at re-engaging the driver, keeping the driver in the loop. How can we do this? There have been different ways to kind of keep the driver engaged in driving. One way is to simply give tasks back to the driver. So let the driver do some things and let the car do some things. But why are we then kind of looking at automation? Another way is to measure the driver's state and to even give back control to the driver when they're getting too tired, which is kind of an interesting kind of conflict. So what's going on at the moment in research and innovation is a look at fully autonomous driving. So instead of increasing the automation level by level, functionality by functionality, and getting the human out step by step, the idea is to look at like fully autonomous driving. And it's quite a different ballgame not to look anymore at the pesky human who is getting tired and distracted and making mistakes. This is more about artificial intelligence and learning, like machine learning, deep learning. It's about kind of maps and it's quite kind of different in some ways. And that's why several car manufacturers and technology companies and also government projects are kind of getting together to into kind of separate research and development streams to explore and to develop full automation further. And this is a real kind of disruptive element in this. So it's not just about having autonomous vehicles on the road. There are other kind of developments and technologies that are coming with this at the same time. For example, electric vehicles, like really kind of light vehicles, but also car sharing and different types of kind of ownership or business models. So then it's expected that with the autonomous vehicles, a lot more will change. So this is about overcoming the intermediate levels. And Tesla, for example, they announced that they would have fully autonomous vehicles within 2 years. We'll see. I'm not so sure. And Ford announced that they might be able to launch them by 2021. And of course, there are many others. There are many, many developments going on at the moment. It's really exciting, including Uber, actually. So, and question for me is, does this mean that we do not need to take the human into account? Basically, how will my job look like then, when we're not researching the kind of human in the intermediate levels? But there are still humans in the vehicles. There are the humans outside of the vehicles, in the wide kind of traffic environment, and the entire society. Regarding the humans in vehicles, of course, they need to trust in order to adopt the cars. And there's just been a survey a few days ago showing that there is actually not a lot of trust in full automation. The drivers, many people actually still want or still expect that they're able to drive at any times. Interestingly, people with experience with Teslas don't require that humans are able to drive so much. So they'd trust the full automation more. About when it comes to kind of emotions, it's not so much about doing the trip anymore. It's about making sure that drivers or people have good experiences in cars. Comfort includes motion sickness, which is a big problem, especially in our simulator experiments, but it will also be in future cars. And this can hopefully be kind of all enhanced with the communication with the car, with the development of natural language interfaces. The car will be able to be more maybe like a friend or like an assistant, a bit like Kit in Knight Rider, with whom you can talk and interact and who can then kind of assist you and care for you when you're like tired and ask you whether you want to listen to some music. And there are all kinds of, and we're looking also at the activities people are doing, performing when they're not driving. Would they still be using a satellite navigation system, for example? Because I think actually, it seems like they do, although they're not kind of guided from one place to another, they might still be using a sat-nav to interact with the outside environment, to kind of know where they are and to look up where the next cafe is. Car manufacturers such as Audi or Jaguar Land Rover don't yet fully expect that the drivers are happy to be fully removed from the driving task, because for many people, driving is actually fun. Say, if you drive like really fast on the motorway or so. So will this be prohibited in the future? And how would the customers handle that? Or would people just be able to drive on racetracks or within certain safe boundaries on the motorway? But then again, if pleasure is risk, how does that fit together? Then we have the humans directly outside of the vehicles. And for them, the safety is crucial. It's very important. And also over time, they need to kind of trust and accept that there are these autonomous vehicles in their environment. A lot of Or several research projects look at fully autonomous vehicles in like more pedestrianized areas. Those would be really kind of slow vehicles. And it's like trust and the safety within like cyclists and pedestrians is a big issue. At the same time, people need to be able to communicate with the driver, say, with eye contact. It's not so easy anymore. There are ways the cars can still signal to the driver that to other people that they are recognized and that it's safe for them to cross the road. When we're looking at the transition period from manual driving to having like more autonomous vehicles on the road to fully towards just having autonomous traffic, there are also kind of regional and cultural differences that might change over time, and all kinds of feedback needs to be fed into research and development, which will be automatized as well. But the transition is going to be a very, very interesting phase. When we look at the traffic environment, this has been mentioned yesterday as well in the robotics panel discussion, ethical considerations, because there are certain dilemmas where you need to decide, for example, between kind of let the driver crash into a wall or turn and kill another person. And similar conflicts are there as well between the driver or the car driving straight ahead and doing nothing and killing one person, or the car kind of steering around and killing five people. And who is making these decisions? Are these the engineers only? Or will there be kind of regulations? Or will it be possible for the driver to make this decision? But how should it work within a few split seconds? And then there will be all kinds of effects on the safety and travel quality. Travel time will hopefully be shorter, and lifestyles as well. So cars are not just like status symbols. At the moment, Teslas are status symbols, especially in some areas. But hopefully, autonomous cars will also be able to improve life of people with mobility issues and make it possible for them to participate in society. And then we'll have connected vehicles, of course, because cars will talk to each other. But then cars will also be able to feed any kind of critical information or problems on the outside world or about the driver to other vehicles or authorities. And this picture is kind of a cute example of kind of a misuse of safe cars, as people kind of believe that autonomous cars would stop for everyone at all times. You could just kind of walk in front of them and they stop for you. And sometimes it works even that a seagull can block and like a container harbor or so because the autonomous vehicles wouldn't move. And now a few words about the society. So a big hurdle still for autonomous vehicles are the laws and regulations. There's still so much to solve, especially like more in some countries and less in others. But that's still considered one of the big problems to overcome. We don't know yet what the effects will be on unemployment, because I mean there is a lot of potential for employment, but in the UK, for example, there are about 700,000 professional drivers, and how their lives would look like in a few years' time, I don't know. I hope not too bad. And this interesting development of what I talked about when I talked about the disruptive element of this, it's also that people don't have to own a car anymore. You could just, in theory, order a car with an app, and then it comes and then it brings you anywhere, and you can just get rid of it at any point and it just drives away on its own. And you could kind of offer this as a mobility, as a full service, which then also includes train trips or plane trips or so. And then there are issues with the security and insurance. Security, because cars can be hacked, everything can be hacked. It has been shown, it has been done, and security improvements have been performed as well. And at the, in the end, would this then have effects on the, or how would the insurance of the future then look like? Because whose fault would be an would an accident be if it's not the driver, and who would then kind of pay for it? I think the car manufacturers would take a lot of the blame and responsibility. So a few words about AI. So what that is enabling is yeah, a lot more comfortable and easy maintenance. Car is doing a lot for you. Of course, I mean, knowing about the driver state, and you can learn a lot about the driver state, actually. At the moment, it's possible for cars to measure like steering inputs and pedal inputs and to kind of infer from it whether you're tired or not. But you can also use eye tracking, for example, and detect certain patterns in eye movements to learn a bit more about your state. Simple example, if you're tired, you're blinking more. If you're stressed, you're concentrating more on the road in front. And would it be necessary for the car to adapt to the driver's personality and needs? If you're aggressive, if you want to rush, should the autonomous car do the same? Or should it be just like, I don't know, comfortable for everyone or just for certain people and drive kind of slowly, like a Rolls Royce and, I don't know, elegantly? As the cars are learning in the road, they may pick up human bad habits. We talked about yesterday in the deep learning session as well. The Google car accident is actually a nice example of this. So what happened in the Google car accident is that the Google car learned that cars are actually at junctions at times, creating like an informal right-turning lane, a right-turning lane that doesn't exist, but people still kind of drive into this non-existent lane. And the Google car did the same in the end. But another car in the actual right lane did not expect this from the Google car. And because of this misunderstanding, those cars crashed into each other. Nothing bad happened. It's just like two damaged, slightly damaged cars. But it has implications on kind of the cars, the autonomous cars, vehicles' behavior. So over time, I'm sure we'll find ways that kind of learning mechanisms can adapt, that you, for example, put some rules in place so this wouldn't happen. But would this always make sense for human beings? So I'm not sure whether autonomous vehicles should drive like humans or whether they should drive like machines. Because there is an expectation that autonomous vehicles are just like really smooth, like trains or like platoons, and just take over all this work, and we'll be fine with that. But there is a lot of research that shows that humans accept and prefer more human-like behavior in vehicle automation. For example, humans would not be comfortable to drive around as curves, to be driven around curves as fast as cars actually safely can. At the same time, are not comfortable necessarily with the short distances that are necessary to have the benefits of platooning. So there will be some kind of time maybe for humans to adapt or for cars to adapt. So maybe autonomous vehicles will be like a better human version. But what is that? And does this mean the same for all humans? And I'm sure there will be disappointment as well. So I, as a researcher, I'm trying to kind of be part of addressing these challenges now, although like the fully autonomous cars out there in the wild don't exist yet. They're just like only in limited areas with like limited speeds, but we have many questions. Yeah, and how can we find the answers now? So in human factors, we kind of looking at the problems and boil them down to really defined research questions. And once we have the questions, we might actually be able to answer or approximate the answers to some degree without having the full scenario there. I mean, we can't do like big studies where we kind of quantify these effects, but we are able to maybe like the study in the simulator research part of it. For example, in the videos we were researching what drivers or people are doing as they are sitting in an autonomous vehicle or automated vehicle, automated for some time. If we, for example, want to look at the effects of autonomous vehicles on elderly people and whether it's possible for them to participate more in society, we might also just as well give taxi vouchers to those people and see how they use them and how it changes their lives. And as then cars are becoming increasingly automated and we might have autonomous cars on the roads at some point, there are more opportunities to actually research this and to find answers to those questions. So, and as a summary, so there are loads of promises and expectations that come with automations that are supposed to increase safety and road capacity. But at the moment, as we are like in those intermediate levels of automation, it's a very exciting research field, but it's very problematic to kind of engage or re-engage the driver when it's necessary. Hence, several car manufacturers and technology companies are kind of getting together to go all the way to full automation. But the human factors challenges still remain. So we still have the humans in vehicles and outside of the vehicles, in the environment and society. And there are interesting challenges coming with artificial intelligence. And we're trying our best in research to kind of tackle these questions now before autonomous vehicles are actually out there properly in use. So coming back to the question with which I started the presentation. So are we taking the human factors researcher out of the loop? And I'm saying no, because the humans still need to be considered. So that's all, thank you.